Hi, I'm Mark Childs. And if you're new to this channel, I'm an internal medicine critical care trained physician with a passion for photography. I've been thinking about what I wanted to speak to you about this week. I thought I'd expand on photography and the power of awe with one of the most powerful inducers of awe, experiencing the universe we live in. And for a photographer, that means I had to learn astrophotography. So, let's do this. As I discussed in my last video, experiencing awe can have incredibly powerful effects on the human brain. Awe has the power to shift our perspective, reminding us of the vastness of the universe and our place within it. This sense of wonder of being a small part of something much greater than ourselves can have a profound impact on our mental well-being. When we experience awe, the human brain releases neurochemicals such as oxytocin, the love hormone, dopamine, and serotonin, all of which help in producing a sense of calm, wonder, and can improve our mental health by promoting emotional, social, and psychological well-being. It can reduce stress, anxiety, depression, and even post-traumatic stress disorder. In a world that often feels chaotic and overwhelming, awe offers a powerful antidote, a reminder of the beauty and mystery that surrounds us. It has the ability to quiet our minds, silencing the constant chatter of daily worries and anxieties. It allows us to tap into a sense of wonder and curiosity that can be incredibly restorative. When we're filled with awe, we're more likely to feel connected to something larger than ourselves, whether it be nature, spirituality, or even the vastness of the universe. The sense of connection can be incredibly grounding, providing a sense of purpose and belonging that can be difficult to find in our everyday lives. Astrophotography, well, that's a whole new realm of photography. And once you get started, it's hard to turn back. Like anything else in photography, you could spend tons of money, time, and hours of learning and editing and learning different techniques, especially if you're going for deep sky photography, such as images of galaxies and nebula, or just choosing between trackers and tripods and lenses for Milky Way shots. But I've discovered that whether you have an outrageously expensive setup or travel thousands of miles to find the perfect skies, or just have a simple setup with a camera or even an iPhone in your backyard, the joy, the wonder, the awe, if you will, actually comes from just being outdoors, gazing at the night sky, and realizing that our world and everything on it is just a mere speck in the vast universe that envelops us. The process of astrophotography itself can be a meditative and awe-inspiring experience. It requires patience, planning, and a willingness to embrace the unknown. Setting up your equipment under a blanket of stars, patiently waiting for the perfect shot, and then witnessing the final image emerge is truly a rewarding experience. Each successful astrophotograph is a testament to the photographer's skill, dedication, and deep appreciation for the cosmos. As a young boy, I grew up in a New Jersey suburb of New York where the night sky often competed with the city's bright lights. Our one-bedroom apartment, perched on the cliffs of the Palisades, though small, did offer a breathtaking view of the Hudson River and the Manhattan skyline. The Empire State Building, ablaze with lights, was a constant presence, a beacon in the night. Yet, even amidst the urban glow, there were moments when the cosmos pierced through, leaving an unforgettable, indelible mark on my young mind. I was about 6 years old when a fiery spectacle unfolded above the New York City skyline. It was a clear evening, and my family was gathered in our living room, which also served as my parents' bedroom, when a brilliant streak of light blazed across the sky. The brilliant fireball, trailing a long luminous tail, illuminated the sky with an unworldly glow, where it disappeared as fast as it came, hurling towards the north, leaving a trail of wonder in its wake. Now, In those days, before the internet and instant news updates, speculation ran wild, and many, with us still in the heat of the Cold War, thought this might be a Soviet attack. But in reality, as we found out in the news the next day, it was a meteor that graced the New York City skyline. The idea that something so large, so powerful, could hurtle through space and illuminate our world for a fleeting moment filled me, even at that young age, with a sense of awe and wonder, a reminder that beyond the familiar sights of my suburban life, a vast and mysterious universe awaited exploration. The summer of 1969 brought with it a different kind of celestial event, one that would captivate the world and ignite a passion for space exploration in countless hearts, including my own. I was 9 years old, spending the summer at a bungalow colony in the Catskills, a world away from our suburban home. The excitement was palpable. Everyone was talking about the Apollo 11 mission, humanity's first attempt to land on the moon. On July 20th, 1969, as I recall, a group of about 50 people gathered in the main hall, huddled around a small black and white television set. The air crackled with anticipation as grainy images flickered on the screen, transporting us across a quarter of a million miles to a desolate yet captivating world. The adults spoke in hushed tones, their faces reflecting the gravity of the moment, while us kids, buzzing with excitement, struggled to grasp the magnitude of what we were witnessing. As Neil Armstrong descended the lunar module's ladder and uttered those iconic words,
"It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind."
A wave of emotion washed over me. I was tasked with adjusting the TV antenna, ensuring a clear signal for our rapt audience. In that moment, as I fiddled with the antenna, I felt an overwhelming sense of connection to the grainy figures on the screen, to the millions watching around the world, and to the vast universe beyond. After the broadcast, I raced outside into the open field behind the hall, and gazing up at the moon, now more than just a celestial object, but a place where humans were now literally walking, I whispered to myself, "There's someone up there right now, walking on the moon." My mind struggled to comprehend the reality of it all. It was a moment of pure awe, a realization that the universe held endless possibilities and that perhaps, just perhaps, I could one day explore its wonders firsthand. From that point on, when outside at night, I first always look upward to the sky. The next few years of my childhood were filled with dreams of becoming an astronaut. Not just an astronaut, but the first physician astronaut. But poor vision requiring glasses made a career as a pilot, let alone an astronaut, in those days highly unlikely. And that dream would have to be abandoned as I settled on half of it in becoming a physician, thus making my mom quite happy. When my kids were growing up, I purchased a reflective telescope. And we'd go out on our backyard, now in a much more rural area than my childhood apartment. And together, we'd spend evenings huddled around the telescope, gazing at the moon's cratered surface, marveling at the rings of Saturn, and tracing the constellations across the vast expanse of stars. Meteor showers became family events, with friends coming over huddled in blankets in our backyard. We'd lie under the stars counting shooting stars, sharing stories of constellations and distant galaxies. These shared moments filled with wonder and a sense of connection to something much greater than ourselves created memories that I cherish to this day. My children, like me, developed a deep appreciation for the beauty and vastness of the universe, a passion that I hope will stay with them forever. One of them even grew up to write programs for satellites at SpaceX. It wasn't until my trip to Africa, however, that I started to seriously consider learning how to photograph the universe. But I knew it would take more than equipment to conquer this challenging field of photography. I started by signing up for local astrophotography workshops, where I met a remarkable person, and now good friend, Noel Thomas, aka At Majestic Flights, known for his stunning images of the Milky Way and deep sky objects. As darkness enveloped one of our local beaches, transforming the familiar landscape into a canvas for celestial wonders, Noel patiently guided me through the basics of setting up my equipment. He explained the importance of polar alignment, using the North Star as a guide to ensure that my tracker would compensate for the Earth's rotation. He showed me how to focus on infinity, using distant stars as pinpoints of light, and how to adjust my camera setting to capture the faint glow of the Milky Way. But what excited me more than learning these techniques was the utter enjoyment I had, being on a dark beach with thousands of stars above, just conversing, getting to know this amazing newfound friend, talking about his life experiences, some quite tragic, and reflecting on how much joy he had in just being outside under the stars. Well, that was just a breath of fresh air. And teaching this passion of his that I know was and is a source of joy and healing in his life, and now mine, was truly inspiring. I was now hooked, and I scoured the internet looking for ideas and astrophotographers to learn from. I came across these stunning captures from Rachel Jones Ross, and I knew where my next venture would take me. In March 2023, I packed my bags filled with warm clothing, camera gear, and a heart brimming with anticipation, and headed up to Calgary, Canada. The Canadian Rockies welcomed me with breathtaking expanse of snow-capped peaks, pristine forests, and frozen snow-covered lakes, a landscape that seemed almost otherworldly in its beauty. After a long flight, I met up with Rachel and her trusty sidekick, Brian Peters, an amazing photographer in his own right. And after a scenic drive from Calgary, we arrived at Emerald Lake Lodge, our home for the next week, and a photographer's sanctuary nestled in the heart of the majestic wilderness. The photos and videos I took on this trip and subsequent adventures with Rachel Bryan and my dear friend, Anthony Cladera of PhotoPills fame, which I showcase here today, are some of my most cherished moments in my photography experience. Sitting in a valley surrounded by majestic snow-covered peaks, this frozen lake, which once thought is truly emerald in color, is one of the most secluded and beautiful spots in the world. I literally could spend the entire week walking around this lodge and get the most amazing captures of a lifetime. But Rachel and Brian, our intrepid guides for the week, and Anthony on subsequent trips, had other plans. Plans that involved late-night adventures, sleep deprivation, in a relentless pursuit of celestial wonders. They had warned me that this week would be a whirlwind of activity, a non-stop photographic immersion designed to maximize our time under the stars. We'd be chasing the Milky Way, hunting for the elusive aurora, and capturing the ethereal glow of golden hour against some of the most stunning landscapes imaginable. The prospect of little sleep and long nights, well, that didn't faze me in the least since I am a physician. And I was here to learn and push my boundaries and experience the Canadian Rockies in all its celestial glory. During this time of year, we would have the holy grail of astrophotography. Golden hours, sunset, Orion peaking, with the Milky Way arch coursing through the late night sky as sunrise approached. And, if lucky, the zodiacal light and the aurora borealis to boot. Combining these events with some of the darkest skies in the world was to make for some of the most amazing natural experiences I've ever witnessed. One of our most memorable excursions took us deep into Jasper National Park, a vast wilderness renowned for its pristine skies and minimal light pollution. Jasper boasts a Bortle Class 1 rating on the Bortle Darkness Scale, indicating an exceptional level of darkness that allows even the faintest stars to shine through with remarkable clarity. We set off from Emerald Lake Lodge late in the evening, our van winding its way through snow-covered forests and past the imposing Columbia ice fields, a remnant of the last ice age. Our destination was Tangle Peak, a majestic mountain that promised a stunning backdrop for our astrophotography endeavors. As we stepped out of the van into the frigid night air, the temperature a bracing minus 24 degrees Celsius, my breath formed icy plumes in the darkness. But the cold was instantly forgotten as I tilted my head back and gazed upward. The sky above Jasper was unlike anything I'd ever witnessed before. A tapestry of stars so numerous and brilliant that they seemed close enough to touch. A river of stars swirling and churning, a celestial spectacle that filled me with a sense of awe and wonder. I chose a spot along a winding riverbed, its frozen surface glistening under the starlight, with Tangle Peak looming majestically in the distance. The air was still, the silence broken only by the gentle crunch of my ice cleats on the snow and the distant murmur of the Athabasca River. I set up my tripod, my hands clumsy with the cold, and began framing my shots, eager to capture this celestial wonder. As I worked in the cold, I couldn't help but feel a profound sense of connection to the universe around me. The vastness of the sky, the countless stars, and the faint glow of the Milky Way filled me with a sense of both insignificance and exhilaration. I was a tiny speck in the grand scheme of things, yet I was also a part of it, a part of it all, connected to every star and galaxy by the invisible threads of gravity and time. As twilight approached, I could see jutting out beyond the peak the magnificent constellation of Scorpio, indicating that the Milky Way was not far behind. And sure enough, just before twilight, the Milky Way lined up perfectly with Tangle Peak. And as it made its way over the peak and the sun rose, I knew that I had imprinted with my shutter a memory for the ages. The rest of the week, as well as was experienced on subsequent trips, was filled with amazing moments. Great friends and memories were made. We captured amazing sunrises, sunsets, golden hours, and Milky Way shots. We stood on the iconic Morantz Curve, made famous by special photographer for the Canadian Pacific Railway, Nicholas Morant, waiting for trains to pass to recreate his iconic photos. I learned how to accurately focus on the stars, expose for different lighting conditions, and lose my fear of using massively large ISOs. But as the week came to a close, we had yet to experience the elusive aurora borealis. With my bags already packed for our departure the next morning, I decided with Brian and a few other newly formed friends to foray out onto the snow-covered lake in the early morning hours to capture the Milky Way arch. And as I set up my tripod and looked through my lens, I couldn't believe what I saw. A faint neon glow, green magenta emanating from the north beyond the mountain peaks. I asked Brian to look and he confirmed the sighting, and I finally now had the opportunity to capture and see in one night a full Milky Way arch with the northern lights. Little did I know is that as amazing as that night was, it wouldn't be until the next two nights when the workshop was over that I would experience the most awe-inspiring, mesmerizing nights of my life. With only a few hours sleep accomplished during the week, I promised my wife a three-night stay at the magnificent Fairmont Hotel in Banff to thaw out and relax. The true creative talent in my life is my wife, who with perfect pitch can play multiple musical instruments and paint a scene more beautiful than I can capture in real life. But photography in the cold was not at that time a mix she was aspiring to. So the next day, when I got the call from Rachel that there was a good chance for an amazing aurora that night, and would I be up for another all-nighter, I looked at my wife with a twinkle of that nine-year-old boy in my eyes, and with an encouraging nod from her, I replied, "Hell yeah." After being picked up by Brian and Rachel, we headed out back to a favorite spot from earlier in the week, Vermilion Lakes. And as the darkness descended with the classic view of Mount Rundle in the distance, I set up my tripod on the ice in front of an ice hole that I captured the reflection of the stars in earlier in the week and waited. And lo and behold, the green hues started to emerge and dance from the left of Mount Rundle emanating from the north, and I captured one of my all-time favorite shots. The aurora borealis, the lights we see in the night sky, emanate from activity on the surface of the sun. As a solar storm occurs, it sends out electrically charged particles. These particles can travel millions of miles, with some eventually colliding with the Earth. Most of these particles are deflected away, but some become captured in the Earth's magnetic field, accelerating down towards the north and south poles into the atmosphere. This is why aurora activity is concentrated at the magnetic poles. These particles then slam into atoms and molecules in the Earth's atmosphere, and when they hit our atmosphere, they glow with a color emerging depending on whether the molecules affected are predominantly oxygen, where we would see yellow or green, or nitrogen, red. What we are seeing, therefore, are atoms and molecules in our atmosphere colliding with particles from the sun. The aurora's characteristic wavy patterns and curtains of light are caused by the lines of force in the Earth's magnetic field. Since this phenomenon emanates from the poles, an unobscured view to the north is the best chance of seeing the most activity. And knowing this, Brian asked if I wanted to head to Lake Minnewaka to get a more northerly view. And I said, well, sure, let's do it. What was to follow over the next few hours until daylight blew my mind. Sitting on a snow-covered lake with not another soul in sight, the sky above Lake Minnewaka erupted into a symphony of light, a breathtaking display of greens, reds, purples, and blues that danced and swirled, illuminating the snow-covered landscape with an otherworldly glow. If I wasn't so bundled up, I would have pinched myself, since what I was witnessing, it just couldn't be real. Brian grabbed a shot of me for posterity before heading back to the car for a nap, but I just couldn't get enough of the wonder and splendor before me. My levels of serotonin and dopamine most assuredly were peaking, and any concerns of the world, negative thoughts or feelings of depression or stress, well, it withered away with an amazingly lasting effect long after leaving Canada. I had accomplished everything I was looking forward to, and even more on this trip. I now felt comfortable adjusting my camera settings in the cold and dark with gloves on, a handy tool even for photography in the warmth of day. I felt comfortable focusing at night, setting up nighttime compositions and how to adjust my exposure settings to capture the universe. Obviously, there was much more to learn, but I came away feeling mesmerized, happy, and fulfilled despite the lack of sleep. But little did I know, my trip still had one more surprise in store. The next day, or rather afternoon, as I turned over my ever-memorable, comfortable hotel bed, I heard the sound of my cell phone chime. It was Rachel again. "Hey, buddy, you up for one last hurrah?" she said. "Hell yeah," I said, grabbing a cup of coffee and having a flashback to the early sleepless nights of my residency. This time, however, I looked to my wife. "Hey, you up for it?" I asked, concerned about her enduring a late night in the cold. "Absolutely," she replied, her eyes sparkling with anticipation. "I wouldn't miss this for anything." It was the spring equinox, and the forecast was for one of the largest solar storms of the year hitting our planet. Back out that night to Vermilion Lakes, the atmosphere was frenetically festive. Much different than any night prior, since everyone in Banff had essentially missed out on the prior night's unexpected storm. And the news was carrying now the prediction of an even bigger one this night. Everyone was out along the lakeside to capture the moment. While Julianne hung by the lakeside behind us, Rachel and I found a spot down the banks of the lake, through the bushes and across a half-melted bog, where we clambered up on a small piece of ice along the now half-melted lakeside. Enough room for just the two of us and four tripods and cameras, we set up shop and waited, but not for long. For as we looked up to the sky, the northern lights presented themselves in full glory, a full KP8 night. The colors now more intense, the movements more rapid, the overall display even more breathtaking than before, if you can believe that. Even with a naked eye, mesmerizing greens, blues, purples, and reds danced in unison, not only in the north, but all around us, up and down, sideways and rotating with the colors so bright, I had to back down considerably on my ISO and exposure settings. I kept yelling back to my wife, "Are you seeing this?" And she happily exclaimed, "Oh yeah," and kept capturing it with her iPhone. After getting dialed into my settings and firing off a few shots, I caught a glance at Rachel, and I noticed that same shit-eating grin that enveloped my face as well. This was a good night, a great night, one for the ages, one that will be imprinted in my memory forever. This journey into the heart of astrophotography began as a quest to capture the cosmos' beauty, to freeze those fleeting moments of celestial wonder. But it evolved into something more profound, a journey of self-discovery and a testament to the awe-inspiring power of the natural world. The Canadian Rockies, with their pristine skies and majestic landscape, served as the perfect backdrop for this transformation, a place where the boundaries between earth and sky seem to dissolve, revealing the interconnectedness of it all. Those nights spent under the stars, chasing the Milky Way and witnessing the aurora borealis' ethereal dance, left an indelible mark on my soul. They ignited a sense of wonder and a thirst for exploration that continues to shape my perspective on life to this day. The technical skills I honed, the challenges I overcame, all paled in comparison to the profound sense of awe and humility I felt when confronted with the universe's sheer scale and grandeur. The journey of astrophotography, like the universe itself, is a journey without end. There will always be new techniques to learn, new celestial events to witness, new wonders to capture and share. And as I continue to explore this path, I do so with a heart filled with gratitude for those fleeting moments of awe, those glimpses into the infinite beauty and mystery that lie beyond our world, reminding me that we are all part of something far greater than ourselves. Thank you. Until next time.
Hi, Rach. What was your favorite part of the trip?
What was my favorite part? We had all those gorgeous frost flowers and fog rolling in over the water. They were so pretty. Just made my heart happy.